Hello, everyone, and welcome to this session on visitor attraction and environmental emergencies. And I'll just ask our three speakers to join me on screen.
Can you get him to
hello?
Give you my number right now. I sent him an email a second ago.
We've got Grainne as well. Hi, everybody.
Yeah.
Lovely. We have got everyone here. Thank you very much for joining us at Communicate. And I think we'll launch straight into it, shall we? So my name is Matt Possels. I am Deputy Director of the Natural History Consortium. And we are putting together the Festival of Nature this year that this conference is a part of. And today in this session, we are going to be exploring the role of visitor attractions in environmental emergencies. And so we've brought together a fantastic panel who are going to bring you some provocations for discussion. And then we're going to launch into a bit of questions and answers. Do drop any questions as they come to you into the chat function on the right hand side. We do also have a couple of polls running in the polls menu. If you just click along to the right from the chat, you should see there as well. So do get involved in that. What I'm going to do is I'm going to ask each of our speakers to introduce themselves because they'll do a much better job of it than I will. And we're going to go around in a bit of an order from wide open spaces through to a kind of mixed media to indoor spaces as well in terms of visitor interaction. So we're going to start with Ben Oliver, who is from Westonbirt Arboretum. So Ben, I'll ask you to jump in first. And I believe I got some slides for you as well, haven't I?
Yes, yeah, you have. Hi, everyone. Thanks for having me. It's great to have this opportunity, although slightly daunting at the same time. If you can just put up the first slide,
absolutely.
Then I can do the introduction. So, yes, I work at Westonbirt National Arboretum, which is part of Forestry England. Which is responsible for the nation's forests. I look after learning and participation here at the National Arboretum, which is near Gloucestershire. That involves everything from formal education through to volunteering, community inclusion, and visitor engagement as well. So, but as I say, hopefully I'm going to rattle through this and kind of give an overview of who Forestry England are and what we do at Westonbirt, and hopefully also have a few questions. Because one thing I should say from the start is that I think, you know, it's really important as an organisation and for me personally that we accept that we don't have all the answers. And I think there needs to be honesty around that. And that's, you know, one of the things I'm very keen on is that we don't try and pretend that we're more than we actually are. We do some great things. Next slide. Sorry, I'm going to sound like Chris Whitty a bit. Just for those people who aren't aware of Forestry Commission or Forestry England. Forestry Commission was set up in 1919. After the First World War, basically to help produce a strategic reserve of timber. Very different setting to today. After the Second World War, it was about employment and actually giving people coming back from the Second World War work to do in the environment. And now, of course, it's moved much more towards engaging with environmental issues, conservation, people, as well as the timber production side of things. So we have always, had the management side of things, but we've changed with the agenda. And again, I think that's important to say, you know, we do have a history, some of it good, some of it less good. And again, being honest with that. There's three parts: Forest Services, which looks after things like grants and licensing; Forest Research, which really does a huge amount of research in terms of social forestry, but also climate change, pest and disease, new species, those sorts of things. And then Forestry England, which is the bit that Westonbirt sits under, which really, as I say, looks after the estate. So if we can go to the next one. So In terms of Forestry England, we are all over the place. So we have around 1,500 woodlands and forests around the site. I always like this one, 99% of people live within an hour's drive, which is fantastic. The little star is actually where Westonbirt is. We are a district in our own right, but we are tiny because we are one site versus something like the West District, which goes from the Wirral down to Cornwall and has places like Forrester Dean. Again, one of the things I'm always interested in is, although 99% of people live within an hour's drive, an hour is still quite a long time. And actually, you know, with increasing urbanisation and other things, actually, you know, I work with people who, you know, live 5 minutes down the road and have never been to Westonbirt and would never see that as a place for them. So it's all well and good saying 99% of people live within an hour, but actually, you know, that doesn't necessarily answer the question as to how do we engage everybody rather than those that just visit our sites. Next question, next slide. So as I say, we are about sustainable forest management, and that's really important. You know, we do management of forests, and, you know, one of the key things, you know, that we passionately believe is that you can do, you know, sustainable forest management. Forestry England produces about 1.4 million tons of timber a year. We almost half of all UK grown timber. And we're all of our sites are FSC certified. So they're all sustainably managed. And it's important that we engage people. You know, management, particularly when forests and cutting down trees, can become a bit of a dirty word. Because of some of the things that, you know, do take place. But it's important to actually provide a different story to that as well, and engage people in that practical side of things. Forestry management is a very long-term thing. You're thinking 100 years ahead. So again, how do we engage people with those longer lifespans? Next slide. But it's not only on the sort of the trees and forest. You know, we do have huge heathlands, moorlands, urban green spaces, and around 60% is actually designated, whether it's SSSIs, ANOBs, Westonbirt's a grade one historic landscape. So, you know, we are doing an awful lot of other things than just timber production, and it's how do we bring those together? And I think one of the things that I'm really interested in is having those difficult conversations with people. You know, that actually there's very few times where it's black and white. You know, every decision is grey. And, you know, to what we plant, to how we manage it, to how we care for it. And again, you know, we have to be honest and say in the past we have got things wrong. But that's part of the process of learning. Again, at the moment, we're very involved in reintroductions of animals. You know, things like white-tailed eagles, beavers, pine martens, red squirrels. The flip side of that is also we're involved in control. So things like deer and grey squirrels. So how do we have those conversations that can be quite contentious with people? Next. So the other thing, you know, we've been doing a lot more of is, you know, the idea of natural capital accounting and actually trying to bring together all the other things within Forestry England. And as I say, you know, we I believe were the first sort of organisation to government organisation to do this. So we got sort of £24.4 billion worth of value to society, you know, which is something that we're monitoring. And again, that's partly about not just seeing things through the prism of timber production or people visiting, but actually that broader environmental benefit. And again, how do we engage people with that? Next. So in terms of the people aspect, which is kind of, you know, in terms of being a visitor attraction, a place where people visit, you know, we do have, you know, a lot of visits, 230 million visits per year ish. You know, at Westonbirt, we have around 500,000. So, you know, 500,000 visits. if you go to the next slide, just to say that, you know, there's a huge range of stuff that our forests have. So, you know, shops, bike hire, you know, running trails, plant centres, illuminated trails, big concerts, you know, an awful lot of activity. And, you know, the interesting thing from my team's perspective is how do we make a space for actually engagement about the, you know, the environmental emergency? How do we bring that in to some of these areas, or all of these areas ideally? And again, how do we go beyond consumption to connection? You know, so, you know, a good day out is what we all provide, or what we should provide. But actually, you know, we need to be more than that. You know, just being a good day out is not good enough. You know, and how do we do that? So next slide. So and as I say, the, you know, there's two very sort of special sites, if you like. I mean, all Forestry England sites are special, but there's two particular ones, Westonbirt and Bedgebury, who are international tree collections. And that does make us a little bit different to the, you know, the wider Forestry England estate, in the sense that, you know, we are scientific tree collections, and, you know, our remit is slightly broader because we have the global tree collection. So in terms of Westonbirt, if you can go to the next sort of slide, sort of just very briefly, there's some pictures showing sort of some of our, you know, plant propagation work. So Westonbirt was a Victorian collection, you know, started by Robert Holford, very wealthy gentleman, and he had a passion for plants. So he basically brought loads and loads of plants in and created this wonderful landscape for his family. Forestry Commission took over in 1956, and was initially a research centre, but gradually over time, more people came to visit, and we've sort of become a visitor attraction as well. So we do a lot of important sort of conservation work, working with a lot of partners, wild collection, ex situ conservation, doing sort of research. So that's Penny in the bottom corner collecting plants. I think that was Turkey, I think. So, you know, we do work with a lot of different organisations. And again, it's how do we bring that collection to people, and how do we, you know, engage them? Again, interestingly for me, one of the questions is going beyond being a visitor attraction and being a scientific collection is what do we mean to the community and how do we engage the community? So next slide. So in 2019, we launched our 10-year plan. It kind of got hijacked by last year and events a little bit. But again, two of the fundamental things that it identifies is the idea of having a position on environmental change. So what do we mean by environmental change and how do we engage people with it? And linked to that is societal change. And I think the great thing is it goes beyond just being a site and actually being something that is trying to promote and create change. And I think that's what all good engagement is about, is creating change. So next slide. So just a couple of things that we are, you know, hoping to work more on. So in terms of enabling positive choices for the future, so, you know, whether that be on things like pest and disease, on, you know, where you get your wood from, what sort of wood you use, you know, how you travel, sustainability, we feel we can make engage people with that. We also want to work a lot more with young people in terms of getting them to engage, but also become agents for their own change. I think the days of, you know, being, you know, us being the experts preaching to people are long gone. You know, we want to create a dialogue and engage people and allow them to get involved and get their sort of creativity and innovation engaged as well. And then how do we as an organization change? And that's really, really important, because, you know, change is not just about, you know, the people that visit us. Change is about who we are and what we are as well. So I'm almost finished.
I might need to hurry you up a little bit there, Ben, so that we've got time for everybody.
In that case, ignore this slide. This is just in terms of visitors. I just want to just finish on this. This is the last one. Just to say that I think one of the things from engaging visitors is starting where they are. So this is from Alva. So again, just shows where, you know, our visitors are coming from. So for example, the social mindset is really important at Westonbirt compared to other places. And again, it's starting where the audience is, you know, is a key area. And just because I'm a tree nerd doesn't mean that everybody who visits Westonbirt will be. And I need to engage them in the appropriate ways. That's me.
Thank you very much, Ben. So going through as well, let's run through straight into Grainne as well from Bristol Zoo.
Great, thank you. I'm going totally low tech. I have no slides. So you just have to listen to me, unfortunately. So yes, I'm Grainne McCabe. I'm head of field conservation and science for Bristol Zoological Society. And we're a company that also runs two zoos. And my job there is to direct our global conservation programs. So we work in 10 countries around the world on 14 different conservation projects. And then I also oversee our higher education programs. So a bit unusually for most zoos, we jointly run 6 degree programs with 4 different university and college partners. And those degrees are in wildlife conservation, zoo veterinary medicine, zoological management. And on any given week, we'll have 350 or so students, pre-pandemic, of course, who would be taking their classes on our zoo campus. So they actually attend our zoo as their campus. And that gives us this additional audience or way of engaging on the ecological emergency, the climate emergency, in a really in-depth way, just as we can with, say, our members that are coming to the zoo repeatedly. So in addition to having visitors and the public that come through the zoo, as Ben said, for a good day out, we also have these repeat visits, which helps us, I think, to engage more deeply with certain elements of our audience. So as a conservation charity, the core of our mission is really to engage the public on issues related to conservation and wildlife and the environment more broadly. And it's really never been more important than now, because we are in real time seeing the impacts of anthropogenic activities, how that can lead to global pandemics, and also a lack of balance in the environment and how that impacts on climate change. And so much like Westonbirt and Forestry England, we have also just launched a new strategy, actually just last month. Our strategy to 2035, which really showcases how we want to move towards becoming a much more sustainable organization and sustainable conservation society, but also to really more deeply engage in trying to bring our visitors along with us in behavior change and in promoting pro-conservation behavior. And I think that's where attractions and zoos in particular can have a really, really big impact, and more than just say advocating for change or promoting awareness of these issues, we really want to give them the tools that they need to make those feasible but sustainable and impactful changes in their lives, which is really at the heart of behavior change. So we've run a couple of behavior change campaigns on things like Marine Stewardship Council fish, MSC certified fish, sustainable palm oil in supermarket products, really showcasing to the public how they have this important consumer power to make change. But we've also done things for wildlife-friendly gardening, the proper disposal of garden netting, which can be fatal for local wildlife. But I just wanted to highlight really briefly, probably one of our most successful outreach and behavior change work has been with local waterway users here in the southwest of England, promoting what's called the Check Clean Dry campaign. So this is to stop the spread of invasive non-native species by properly cleaning your equipment when you move between water sources. And as the Zoo Society, in association with our partners, we've recruited and trained over 500 volunteer surveyors who will go out surveying for invasive species in different waterways. And we've promoted that campaign to over 5,000 waterway users. And so really working closely with partners, but working also with those people who are our members, who are our students, we've launched an accreditation scheme for site managers that will agree to a certain set of program standards of biosecurity for their sites. And that then encourages their waterway users in better in behavior change as well. So we start to see that snowballing effect of our project and then how it can impact on the public engaging more in these sort of wildlife and ecological emergencies. And I think that showcases the role that, again, zoos can have in promoting awareness of the ecological emergency and the climate emergency, but also many attractions that have people that come through their doors. Maybe their motivation for coming is not to learn more about these issues, but once they're there, we have the capacity to engage them in really meaningful ways, especially if they're coming back time and time again. I think that's something that is going to be our focus moving forward in this new strategy that we've just launched.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Grainne, for that as well. And then without further ado, to make sure that we have time for some discussion as well, is we launch straight into you, Roddy, as well.
Yes, hi. I'm going to see if I can share my presentation that didn't work last week. Right, can you, that's coming up, but you're getting that view. Right. Oh, no.
No, if you go back on, that was working for us, Roddy.
Yeah, I just can't see the rest of you at all. Never mind, that's okay. So yeah, hi, my name is Roddy. I work at We The Curious and I'm the Sustainable Futures Innovator there. We're an educational charity and my job essentially within this role is to manage our sustainability projects and strategy. For those who don't know much about our centre, we're based right in the heart of Bristol by the harbour side. And we have about 300,000 visitors coming through our doors every year. About 70,000 of those of people are school children. And we also have quite a large site that we're based on. Just outside with the Curious, we have Millennium Square. It's got a big silver disco ball, which is our planetarium. We have about 91,000 people across that area every single week. So we've got quite a big reach with our audience. And just on that note, by the planetarium, we also have a big screen where we share content as well. The goal really of our science centre is to kind of break down the barriers for visitors when it comes to talking about science and other kind of complex topics. We really want to make information fun and accessible and playful, and we're kind of a fully interactive centre. We have teams of people that welcome you when you come in through the door and then put on activities and workshops. You really get this fully immersive experience when you come to our centre. And there is a manifesto behind our centre as well. And we have 5 pledges within our manifesto that help drive these aims. And they are to cultivate curiosity with our visitors, open up science in our city, strive for sustainable futures, enable diverse participation. And our 5th pledge really builds on all of these is to build resilience together. Now, on June the 5th in 2019, we declared a climate emergency. At the same time, we also declared that we would pledge to be carbon neutral by 2030. At the time, we believe we are the first science centre to do so. And we also joined institutions and our local council in being the first people to declare this climate emergency within our city. And later on, we also supported the ecological emergency strategy as well. Now, there are a number of reasons why we did this. First of all, we are obviously a science centre, so we looked at the science. And as Ian has talked about right at the beginning of this conference, the IPCC report was a fundamental driving force in making people wake up the realization of what we need to do by 2030 and by 2050 and really limit the global warming to 1.5 degrees. So the science was pretty clear on that one. So our next step was to look at what's going on around the city as well. And there were Bristol youth strikes for climate. The Bristol City Council in late 2018, I think it's in November, they declared a climate emergency. The University of Bristol did as well in April 2019. And then the UK government, there's a big kind of global movement as well. So that kind of seemed to make sense to us that we would be kind of joining these institutions in declaring this emergency. But we knew it was important for our staff as well. So we consulted our sustainable futures team. As part of the team that I now manage, it's a rep from every department to see if they think their teams would be on board. And we did open up the conversation for the rest of our staff as well, but everyone seemed to be completely on board with this initiative. And we did further research to kind of really prepare ourselves to make the next step. So we kind of looked at what does it mean to declare a climate emergency, and importantly, like action plans around that. And then by the time it came to June, we were ready, and we had an action plan in place to put into effect, and we declared an emergency. And whilst sometimes a lot of the messaging around climate change can be quite scary and anxiety inducing, and that's a very valid response. We knew that this kind of state of crisis was also a opportunity. And an opportunity for us to change, to listen to other people, especially to our visitors and our communities around the city, to be an exemplar, not only a visitor attraction, but as an organisation to operate sustainably and share that best practice with organisations around Bristol, and that it's an opportunity to build essentially a better world together. And with that, all of that, the messaging would be hope-led and not fear, driven by fear. So I mentioned that I had an action plan. Said we've also declared to be carbon neutral, but here are some of the things that we said we would do. I won't kind of go into all of them, but essentially we're diverging away from using fossil fuels. We're going to be changing appliances that use gas to electric over the next kind of coming years. That includes our vehicles as well, and equipment that we use on site, and supporting more kind of say like electric car charge points in our car park. We've already done a lot of sustainability initiatives over the last kind of 10 years as well. So that's kind of, so we're not like new to this. We've got a lot of experience. We know what we can and can't do, and we're still kind of challenging ourselves with that. A few more, and some of the immediate kind of things we did was to change all our electricity. Electricity source to be that be from a sorry a renewable energy source and be fully traceable, and to stop having an ice rink because that was a huge water and energy consuming kind of process to kind of go through. And we audited our things like our palm oil as well, so we kind of looked at the procurement stages as well. I'll mention this before I get into the next bit, but I've mentioned the operating stuff that we're doing. We've also put on a whole year of climate change themed programming, so how we engage with the visitors was really important. And we tackled things around, as I said, like palm oil, air pollution, how can you create things more sustainably? So put on like little craft workshops, or that's like our Santa's eco-invention workshop. Also ended up partnering with WWF and Netflix and Google in a rewild experience as well during summer of 2019. It was fun, it was creative, it was interactive, and we had great feedback and we had lots of learning outcomes from it, which I can happy to share. But I do want to make sure we all have time for questions as well. So I'll say the last thing I'll say is the fact that I've shown you a few things that we've done. We've been doing sustainability for the last 10 years. It's important that we recognize that we've got this experience, and it puts us in this place of privilege and also a responsibility to help kind of share our knowledge and share our experience with other organizations, like both locally and kind of nationally. And we've also got an international kind of audience as well, with kind of digital content online, and also with our partners as well. And I think that's pretty much where I'm going to leave it.
Thanks very much, Roddy. Thank you very much. And if you want to just knock the screen share off, there we go. Thank you so much. There's so many great examples in there as well. And don't forget to sort of, if you want to drop any questions in the chat. So unbelievably, we only have 10 minutes left. So the best use of that 10 minutes, I think, will be to really have a look. I think there was a really, really interesting point that kind of grew out. There was a bit of a common thread that ran through everything that you're all saying in those great examples. You're all working in very different contexts, but you're all visitor attractions in one way or another. And there seems to be these kind of this duality that you're having to navigate, particularly in a world where many of you will have had periods of closure over the last year or year and a half, 2 years. And there's this kind of duality of both what you do with your physical sites and the kind of response of activity that you can do, things like cancelling the ice rink or using different power sources and things like that, but also this kind of visitor influence role of behaviour change and engaging people with the issues. And I wonder maybe if it's just kind of 2 minutes from each of you going round and thinking about where you think that duality kind of comes together and where things might sort of diverge. You as an organization can approach those things and what kind of role that you feel you can have as a visitor attraction. Shall we run round in the order that we started? Ben, do you want to tag? I'll throw Ben on the spot first.
I was hoping you'd say we'd do it in reverse. No, it's a very interesting point. I mean, I think one of the things where there's interfaces, visitors are coming for lots of different reasons. And I think, you know, that idea of, trying to almost surreptitiously engage them with these things. I mean, they've come for a good day out. That hope, not fear, is a really important part of that. I mean, we do have anecdotal evidence that some of our climate change programs, for example, haven't been selected because they're worried about the impact it'll have on students' well-being. So again, it's how do we engage with that. I think the nice thing about Westonbirt is that we can do things that are very practical to engage people. So whether it be, waste audits, looking at our bins and saying, you know what, we're getting so much contamination that actually we can't recycle a lot of the stuff because we need to look at how people are putting the rubbish in the bins and look at food waste and engaging people. And rather than putting that back of house where nobody sees it, shove it right out in visitors, get people engaged. Similarly, when we're looking at things like Kalara, ash dieback, that's big practical changes that we're having to look at. And how do we do that in a way that engages visitors in that story, in that narrative? So for example, community planting is something that we're looking at. We've had to take out about 4 hectares of ash trees, which is, quite a lot of trees. We're hoping, it's about the resilience of future woodland. So what trees are we going to plant? What species, and actually gauging visitors to plant those trees as well.
Hi, Debbie.
Probably plenty from me.
Perfect. No, thank you very much. And then so we jump in with Grainne.
I can hear you.
So I think for us, we deal with this quite a lot. So how do we engage our visitors or our students, but at the same time, make sure that we're doing things in-house and being leading a good example and not being preachy at the same time. And also realizing that for a lot of people, they have significant problems without having to worry about sustainability. So I think we need to remember that for some of us, thinking about conservation, thinking about ecological emergencies is a privilege. And a lot of people's lives are they have very serious things they're dealing with, and they can't always be thinking about recycling or looking for things that have sustainable palm oil. So trying to find solutions where we can talk to people about what they can do that are small but impactful, but at the same time, trying to change our structures, maybe a little bit like Ben was suggesting there, so that they can just go about their day, but they're contributing. And so we're trying to do that obviously internally with, you know, the things that we sell in our shop, for example, the things we sell in our cafe, making sure that if people do buy something there, they're automatically doing something that's helping the planet. But then also working with our external partners and working with the city and thinking about transport and other things. How do we, as a sort of a recognizable business and organization within Bristol City, how do we use our power and our leverage to help influence things and work with people like We the Curious and like other partners to make sure that we're putting structures in place, or helping the city to put structures in place, and sustainable transport is just the one that comes to mind, but there are other examples, so that people simply get on the bus and go to their job and do their day, but they're automatically already doing things that are important or contributing towards sustainability and conservation. So I think we're trying to do things as much as possible from sort of that behind the scenes, as much as we are about telling the public about the things that they can feasibly do in their life. I hope that answers your question.
No, I think that's great. I think this brings up a really important point as well around, it's not really possible to go it alone. I mean, we've got sort of three attractions here that are all kind of geographically quite close together, concentrated around the west of England. And I think that, you know, you'd see replicated in lots of parts of the country would be these kind of similar clusters of visitor attractions who are all very aware of each other. There's kind of competition for attention and over, you know, summer weekends and things like that, that is kind of all organizations that are aware of each other. But there's so much collaborative around this that actually you can't just go it alone with some of this stuff. And there really is that kind of need to be able to learn from each other and to connect, particularly when you're looking at things on like a city or regional scale. The infrastructure for the region has a huge influence on how people get to your attraction and interact with your spaces as well. So I think that's a really useful and as well. Shall we then, Roddy, do you want your 2 minutes to shine on that one as well?
No, I was just going to say, like, that collaborative approach is exactly what I think we're going for. We've like partnered with Bristol Zoo before on our sustainable palm oil campaign. But also like just with lots of organisations, and I said there are good like partnerships, Bristol Green Capital partnership, but then and cities are a great way of like connecting kind of businesses and organisations and sharing and like disseminating kind of information at different levels as well, and visitor attractions are great for kind of making those things, as I said, Grainne was saying, like things more accessible, making it more palatable. Like we are in a position where we can put in the research and the time and the money that makes it just that bit easier for people to kind of engage in and understand. And I think that's like my 2 cents on that. But, yeah.
Fantastic. And I think we've got some comments jumping in as well into the track of interesting things about purchasing power, sharing what the company attraction of doing, encouraging others to be part of the change. I think it kind of follows that there's a little bit of kind of making sure that these things come across as genuine as well, of you know, that also seems to be a sort of common thread of making sure that, you know, the organization is doing everything it can whilst it's asking people to do these kind of small actions that they can,
and sharing that as well. I think as well. There's one big part that sometimes I think we can fall short of is sharing like the small bits, like the detail that people think, okay, what are you doing? Like, okay, like clearly we're not getting across. We got these kind of big, more, I say, like, you know, say like advertising climate change theme programming, like science big and sexy and stuff like that. But maybe getting our suppliers this. To not use these kind of plastic Wotsits in their packaging and stuff like that doesn't sound so cool and appealing, but it's something that is very easy to influence, literally just by asking and providing alternatives, and but doesn't necessarily gain the traction. But I think it's important to share like the small bits and the journey.
And I suppose those are the very quick ones. I'm sorry, and you go, Ben.
No, I was just going to agree with that. I mean, our program manager gets very excited about sort of pipe lagging, and it's not very sexy, but it actually, you know, it's important, and it's a very simple thing that people can think about, you know, at their own homes as well. So, you know, having that simple stories are really important.
Yeah,
I think that's bringing us very close to the end of our time, amazingly already. But I think, you know, there's kind of some really great just strands that have come out of that I hope, you know, people are able to pick up on and look into a little bit more as well, because I think we've really seen a theme there around kind of genuine change within the organization and infrastructural change that really gives a really genuine voice to that narrative, and that it's not always necessarily the sexy things that need to go out there. You know, there's always things, a little bit of greenwashing. You know, if actually the best thing would be to sort out geothermal for the site, but actually no one sees that because it's underground, so we're going to stick a great big wind turbine up because everyone can see that we're doing something green. You know, there's that kind of side of things, but then also the you know, really bringing that narrative and bringing your visitors and people along with it is a huge part of the story as well. So thank you a huge amount for all of that inspiration and those tales from very different visitor attractions, but there's some very common themes running through there. And I hope everyone will thank us. Join me in thanking our speakers for taking part as well. And then we are rushing straight off into the next round of sessions. Some of you, if you are heading towards the toolbox around imagery and social media, you will see me there, and for anyone going everywhere else, then enjoy the rest of your afternoon as well. And once again, a huge thanks to Ben, Roddy, and Grainne as well. Thank you very much. And if everyone just wants to turn their cameras off at the end of the session, we'll bid you adieu.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.